Well, well. What do we have here?
Who are you?
More importantly, my friend, who are you?
Dooku gets captured by a bunch of pirates. Yes. Now that, I think, is very hard to believe, except that there are 30 pirates around him.
Are these what you were looking for, Jedi?
Now, I agree wholeheartedly that Dooku is incredibly powerful. But the fact remains that if he gets into a fight with 30 pirates, yes, he might kill 15 of them, but he will get shot and he will go down. All you gotta do is watch Attack of the Clones. How does Count Dooku thwart those Jedi? Sheer numbers. Sheer numbers will defeat the Jedi.
You must be overly optimistic if you think...
For George, I think it was interesting to have Dooku captured so that Obi-Wan and Anakin could confront him, so that you have some interaction between these characters that usually normally only happens at the end of a sword point.
They are devious and deceitful, and most importantly, stupid.
It's a wonder you don't get along with them, Dooku. You have so much in common.
We hadn't really done an episode where Obi-Wan and Anakin were together and had a lot of dialogue.
How can I become a Jedi Master if I'm always getting caught?
At least you're a master at getting caught.
Very funny.
This was a chance for like the boys to get together and kind of make fun of each other and pick on each other. Anakin was a little rocking him at one point. Ahsoka took a very big back seat in this episode.
Sorry, Snips. Only two this time.
She's kind of got the view of like, what are you guys up to now? You see that they've all kind of got to know each other a little better, and you know, she's still at this point criticizing them kind of outright.
You let him get away?
No, not get away exactly. Just chime in anytime.
Oh no. I'm enjoying this far too much.
You know, I'm not going to help you out. I'm really enjoying this because I used to have this problem with you.
Exactly.
You used to tell me what to do, you know.
And you will learn your place, young one.
So she's obviously picked that up from Anakin. But you get to see the interaction between Obi-Wan and Anakin and understand why she kind of behaves the way she does a little better. Because, you know, she's a young kid with these two guys.
Oh, I see. So which part of the situation did you have under control? The blocked entrance, the poison gas, or that Gundark behind you?
Gundark.
Dooku captured is the first time on screen that we see a Gundark, which is a creature that's referenced in Empire Strikes Back when Luke is recovering from his Wampa attack and Han says,
"He looks strong enough to pull ears off a Gundark." Thanks to you.
It was a throwaway reference in 1980. It's funny because there are lots of throwaway references to other places and events in the Star Wars movies, but this is one we followed up on.
I thought Gundarks were only found on Vankor!
Then this system must be Vankor.
We used the monster manual. There was a Gundark in there.
Oh, the Star Wars monster manual?
And then we had Killian Plunkett adapt it.
We did try different sort of more animalistic-looking Gundarks. We tried some that looked more like bats. We tried some that looked more like wolves. The main thing was that the ears be prominent because they had to be visible because we know Gundarks have ears.
Jump in anytime!
Oh, you're doing fine.
Eventually sort of ran all these designs by George. He really liked the pre-existing one that was from the source book for the role-playing game and actually told us to match to that as closely as we could with a little bit of wiggle room. The biggest difference between the Clone Wars Gundark is that it's got a mane, more like a wolf or a lion. It's got a little more fur. Perhaps the only other difference is that the Clone Wars Gundark has four nostrils like a Tauntaun. The older design only had two, but it's really close.
Remember, Anakin, this could still be a trap.
You're not worried about Dooku, are you?
No. I'm worried about these pirates.
George is a big fan of the pirate movies back in the 40s, and he really brought that out in this story. We wanted to develop Hondo and Naka and his group of pirates.
Even a Sith Lord is no match for my warriors.
And really make them different than other scallywags we've seen before.
We put up quite a fight. Blasters, cannons, that glowy thing.
One thing he would definitely wanted to see was them to be flying, flying saucers.
Mm-hmm.
That were really well armed, but just, you know, right down to the flying saucer sound effect.
There's the small pirate scout ship, and then there's the giant pirate mothership. The main sort of the root sound for both of those is a theremin. It's that 50s sci-fi, classic sci-fi sound. That's the instrument that was used for almost every, I'd say B sci-fi movie, but pretty much every sci-fi movie in the 50s used a theremin.
Exactly. This is something that I think George has been trying to get into Star Wars for a very long time. He didn't get to use them in the features. Does not mean he won't use them here. And he has them in mind and he brings them up. And next thing you know, they're flying around the Clone Wars. There are certain things in Star Wars that George likes to be very consistent. One of them is like that certain aliens represent certain factions. And Weequay, which were, you know, used as skiff guards on Jabba's palace, he decided would make very good pirates. Killian Plunkett designed a system with which the characters of the pirates could be interchangeable.
Very, very difficult. This was the first time that George specifically called for multiple characters in every shot. And ultimately, we did what we had to do, which is cheat. Apart from Hondo, who is the leader of the pirates, pretty much every other pirate you see is a clone. We tried to come up with something like a paper doll system where you would build an alpha version of a male and female pirate and they would have a very basic, simple outfit. And then on top of that, you could add other elements.
They had hair plugs, they had different vests, jackets, guns, holsters, gloves, bracers, boots, shoulder armor. It was all kind of interchangeable. That was a big step for us. We'd never done that kind of thing before. So for the first time, you see these large crowds of people, and they have a lot of individual characteristics.
It's surprisingly effective. It's pretty interesting how much you can get away with by basically taking the same two actors and dressing them up over and over again with slightly different outfits. I think we got a fair amount of mileage out of a relatively small amount of elements.